regardless, right? There are people who would tell you, I love you, but, and then there are people who would tell you they love you and walk away from you, but God will never leave you, amen? Turn around and shake hands with that one beside you, give them a high five, a fist bump, a smile or something, and just let them know how glad you are to see them this morning in church. All right, so good to see you all. We are so happy that you're here. How you like the new desk here? Doesn't that look nice? Yeah, I didn't build it. Adam did. His creativity. And so, yeah, I thought it was pretty nice. So, yeah, I appreciate people who can do beautiful things, beautiful work that I can't do, right? You know what I mean? And you wonder, how in the world they do that? Anyway, thank you so much. All right, we'll let the boys and girls go to children's church. And Brother Adam is back there waiting on you. And our prayers are with you all, that God would minister to you greatly back there as well. And for the rest of us that do not get to go back there, make it exciting, right? I want you to find a Connect card in the seat just in front of you. If you will fill that card out for us and put your information on there, and also put your prayer needs on there. We would love to pray with you, for you, about the needs that are in your life that you're facing right now. There is not a human being on planet Earth, I believe, right now that does not have some concerns, some problems, some situations, some illnesses, whatever. That's why we like to do this and like to have prayer meeting. And while we're on the subject, we had an increase in prayer meeting prayer warriors yesterday, and that was quite an encouragement. So next Saturday morning at 9 o'clock, we invite you to come and join us. We will be praying over these cards, but we'll also be praying for the Sunday morning service as well as a whole bunch of other things. So we invite you to come and join us and be a part of the prayer meeting with us next Saturday morning. And we'll use these cards and be praying over the needs in, on these cards as well. So fill the card out. The ushers will come by shortly, and you can drop it in the bag then. And if you don't have it done by the time they come by, they'll be standing at the door on your way out, and you can drop it in the bag then. Also, you will find the offering envelopes there in the pocket in front of you as well. So let me give you just a few announcements. This coming Wednesday night is the night. Some thought it was last Wednesday night, but this coming Wednesday night is the night that we're having family night. It's going to be family night here in the church. We're going to have, there'll be popcorn, there'll be hot chocolate, and I know that doesn't seem to go together, but believe you me, it will. And we'll have water and other things like that too, and I've heard that we're going to have homemade marshmallows as well. So we're going to have a big night. We've got a movie lined up to show that the entire family is going to enjoy. It may be a little nostalgia for some of us, and the kids are going to enjoy it. It's a good, clean Christian movie. That's what we would show at church, right? Okay, are you with me this morning? Okay, all right. So we're going to be doing that this coming Wednesday night at 6:30, and you're invited. Every one of you are invited, and bring someone with you, because we're going to have a good time. Everyone is invited. We will resume small groups again in January, but right now we're taking a little break because of the holidays, and we'll resume those in January. So there are a few other things that are happening. We have breakfast at the barn every Friday morning, just so you know. And some call it men's breakfast, but it's more than just men, so it can be for anybody, and you're invited to come and be a part of that breakfast. But on Christmas, the Friday before Christmas, which is December 23rd, I believe, we're going to have a Christmas breakfast. And it's everybody that wants to come, and all we do is ask you to bring a covered dish, breakfast dish, and we're going to get the day started off. We'll try to begin eating around 7:30 because some of you have to get out and go to work and go other places. So we will begin around 7:30, but you're invited, okay? This past Friday, I think it was maybe 15-ish that we had there, 10 or 15, something like that. Everyone is invited. And bring your favorite breakfast specialty, whatever it is. It may be even donuts from the donut place. I don't care. Just bring whatever. So it's covered. It will be covered, right? So bring it on, and we're going to have a blast here on that Friday before Christmas. Then several people are wanting to know, what are we going to do about church on Christmas? What are you supposed to do about church on Christmas? You're supposed to have church. We're going to have church here on Sunday morning. It's going to be a special day. That's 2 weeks from today, Christmas morning, 10 o'clock. We will be having church. We'll be having communion. We'll be having a special time of worship, and we invite you to come. Bring your family. Be a part of that. Open the gifts and run to church, and we will not keep you all day. We're going to try to keep it within an hour, okay? So it's going to be good. I want you to just feel welcome to come on and be a part of that as well. Because of the holidays, we're not doing a lot of church gatherings as far as all of us come together like we did on Thanksgiving. But what we are wanting to do is, and we're going to let you vote whether or not you want to be a part of this, and that is show up, or if you're against it, don't show up. But this will be on New Year's Day, which is 3 weeks from today. Can you believe it'll be 2023, 3 weeks from today? We're going to have a New Year's Day lunch. We invite you to come and be a part of it. Black eyed peas, hog jowls, what else? Green cabbage, whatever. Just bring it on. We're going to have a blast. Everybody bring a covered dish on that Sunday, and we'll have the service, the very first service of the year on the first day of 2023, right here. And then we'll be moving over to the barn for lunch. And you can bring your specialty for New Year's Day. It's a holiday, I know, but it's the day we have chosen as Christians to worship the Lord. So we're going to do that, even though it is New Year's Day. And they say whatever you do on New Year's Day, you'll do every day for the rest of the year, right? We're not going to do that. We're not going to have church and dinner every day for the rest of the year. But we will have church every Sunday, the Lord be willing. All right. So we're gearing you up, getting you ready for what's coming on January the 8th, which is the beginning of 21 days of prayer and fasting. So we're trying to fill you up with the breakfast and all your Christmas goodies, and then a New Year's Day lunch, and then beginning our 21 days of prayer and fasting beginning on January 8th. And then, as I said, small groups will kick off again in around that same time in January. All right? If you didn't pick up a devotional, there are more devotionals out there on the counter on your way out to the right. Just pick up one on the way out the door. And there are several more. If you want to give one away, you're welcome to do that. You can put your name on it and give it away as a Christmas gift if you'd like. Know someone that would like to have one. Okay. We're going to ask our ushers if they would come. We want to give you an opportunity this morning to give as giving to the Lord. Also, a time to put your prayer cards in if you would like at this time, or you can do it when you're going out the door as well. We want to give you that opportunity today. Bow your heads with us, and let's talk to God. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on us, letting us see another Christmas season right here in 2022. For many of us, we thought we would never see this day. But Lord, you've blessed us. You've brought us to this moment. You've provided for us. You've taken care of us. And we just want to say thank you right now. And Lord, we come to the part of the service here where we give back to you a portion of that you have given us. We give it to you, ask you to take it and multiply it and use it for the upbuilding of your kingdom and the ministries here in this place, but not only in here, but through this church in ministries locally and even abroad to the far ends of the earth. I pray your blessings. Blessings on everyone that have to give and those who do not have to give. Lord, we ask you to open a door, provide for them a job, that they too can have an income, that they too can partake in the principles of giving that you've put forth in your word. I pray your blessings on each and every person in this house today. And when we leave this service today, every one of us will have known that we've been in the presence of God and that we have heard from God today. Thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for this day. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Thank you.
So, you all look Christmassy. Are you in the mood? Are you in the spirit, the right spirit, the Christmas spirit? I love this time of the year. I love this time when we can celebrate family, we celebrate friends, we can celebrate Jesus Christ. And how is your giving going? I'm not talking about to the church. I'm talking about your giving of gifts. Have you bought anybody a gift? How many really enjoy shopping? And all the ladies. Online shopping, all right. All right. How many enjoys receiving? Oh, we got a good crowd here this morning. Nobody wants anything. All right. So you thought there was a catch to that, but it wasn't. Last week we began talking about the missional response to Christmas. The missional response to Christmas. Not just a response to Christmas. Response to Christmas for many people are the extravagant decorations or gifts or parades or whatever, but the missional response to Christmas. You know, there was a purpose behind it all. And whether you realize it or not at this point, I hope you have, but Christmas didn't happen so that we could put up lights and trees and open presents and invite the family over and cook for them. And that's not why we have Christmas. Christmas all came about because John 3:16, God so loved the world that He didn't want us to die in our sins. He didn't want us to follow the trail of death that ran from Adam all the way through. But He wanted us to have eternal life, so He gave His only begotten Son for you and for me, for every one of us. And some say, well, that's for the pastors, or that's for the church folks, or that's for the Christians. No, He didn't come to save Christians. He came to save humanity and make all of us Christians, which means we're Christ followers now. So that's the purpose of Christmas, and we all have to make a response to a missional response to Christmas. So last week we talked about Mary. Mary made a response by giving herself. That was really far out for a young virgin to hear the words that you're going to conceive, you're going to have a child, and it's going to be the Son of God. He's going to sit on the throne of His father David. That's a pretty big thing. And Mary said, let it be. Here I am. All God is asking this morning is for you to give yourself, your body. But then He is asking for a little more. And this is what we're going to talk about today. This is Joseph's response. How many control freaks do we have in the house today? I'm going to tell you what. I like control of myself. I'm not controlling you, but I like having control of myself. And my wife would think I like having control of her. The dogs better do what I tell them to do, you know. I've got a collar that makes sure of that. When I tell Chaz, that 80-pound English bulldog, to do something, I don't mean that's a multiple choice or if you want to. I mean, you're going to do it. And my kids were raised that same way. And I mean, I didn't have collars for the kids. I did not. But I do for the bulldog and the Cocker Spaniel. We sometimes like control. I like control of my life. Some of you will remember, dreadfully so, years back when this pastor on this platform stood and proved his fact that he had confusional migraines. And when he had a confusional migraine, he did stupid things. Does anybody remember that? I was hoping you wouldn't, but... And the biggest problem with that is when I know that I'm not about to have one now, so calm down. My wife is watching me closely. But the problem with that confusional migraine is I know that I'm losing control of myself, and it makes it worse. Okay? Have you ever experienced anything like that when you something is happening to you physically and you can't stop it because you're a control freak and you want to be in control? Well, here's where we're going with this today. I want it my way. Many of us are like that. We have our planner. You got a planner? A calendar where you know what you're going to be doing tomorrow and next week. And some people, they can tell you within just a moment what they're going to be doing 6 months from now. I don't plan that far out, but I on the little things, that is, but I do have a planner. It may be an electronic planner or a paper planner or a spiral bound. You know what I'm saying? How many has their planner filled? You know what you're going to be doing. You know, you have no room to book anything else. Let me ask you, have you ever handed your plans over to God and said, hey, here are my plans? Have you ever done that? Have you ever said, God, could I have a moment of your time? Here are my plans. Just wanted you to know what I'm going to do. Well, that's kind of what we're going to start with today. Here are my plans, God. So you've got plans, every one of you, plans that you're going, what you're going to do after the service, the evening, the week ahead, and even Christmas, and on. And I'm up here making announcements, and you're like, I can't do it that day. You know, I can't do it. That's the way our planners are. But here we are. We're going to say to God, here are my plans, God. And this is where we begin the story in the book of Matthew, chapter 1, verse 18 through 19. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph. Have you any of you ever been betrothed? That is the same thing as engaged, okay? You've been spoken for. You have a fiancé. You're going to get married. You a girlfriend, boyfriend, but a little more than that. Perhaps to even wearing the engagement ring, putting a ring on it, you know what I'm saying? All right, Mary was betrothed to Joseph, so Joseph had a plan. Before they came together, though, and the words came together could mean either sexually or before they came together, even with them moving into the same house, the same facility. She was found to be with child of the Holy Spirit. So that's what we talked about last Sunday, how Mary found out she was going to have a baby. Well, Matthew starts it from another angle here, and he's talking about Joseph. From Joseph's perspective, Joseph has to give a response. Joseph has to give a missional response. So verse 19, her husband Joseph, being a just man, unwilling to put her to shame, sounds like a good man, doesn't it? Resolved to divorce her quietly. I think so many times we misunderstand Joseph. When we think of the story of Mary and Joseph, we think of a young man, a young wife, got engaged, you know, making wedding plans, and da-da-da-da-da. You know, it's going to be all hunky-dory. But that's probably not the real story. Historical documents give us a little more information on this man, Joseph, than what may actually be recorded in the scripture about the man, because we are very limited on information in the Bible about Joseph. But it is believed that Joseph was much older than Mary. It's believed that Joseph was an old man. It is believed that he first got married to another woman when he was 40 years old. Okay, so hang on with me. And when they had been married 49 years, his wife died. And in that 49-year period, they had 6 children by the first wife, before Mary ever came into the picture. And this is what history tells us about Joseph. And there's a lot of writings that talk about this. So probably when the angel appeared to Joseph in a dream, he was possibly 90 years old, engaged to a young woman who was now with child of the Holy Spirit. You say, Pastor, that didn't make any sense. In biblical times, it did. I mean, in biblical times, it did make sense, and that's the way they lived. However, it is also believed that Joseph possibly died at the age of 111, sometime between Jesus' 12th birthday and the ministry of Jesus, somewhere in that area, probably around the age of 111. And the reason we believe that to be so is that we read of Jesus being 12 years old teaching in the temple when his mother and father, Joseph, was on their way back home from the temple, and they realized that Joseph was not, or that Jesus was not with them, so they turn and go back. So at that time, Jesus was 12, but then all of a sudden, Jesus, his life goes on without mentioning anything hardly of Joseph at all. And one of the gospel writers doesn't even mention Joseph at all. And it's possibly because Mark was writing his after the fact, after Joseph had died and Joseph was a memory. However, at this particular time, Joseph, an old man by now, and his bride-to-be, which is pregnant, and he knows the child is not his, but he's. Okay, we're looking at this from 2023 back to what was happening 2,000 years ago, over 2,000 years ago. And we know the Christmas story, but Joseph didn't. Okay? So let's try to go back to Joseph's life here. Finding out that he, it could have been an engagement like a redemption of sorts, like we find in the book of Ruth. We don't know for certain, but with this older man and a younger bride, we find this story set up. And now Joseph is told in a dream, so he has already heard that Mary is pregnant. Can you imagine the situation where this man all of a sudden realizes that this woman he's engaged to, betrothed to, is pregnant? Up until this time, even with the miraculous birth of Isaac with Abraham and Sarah, up until this time, every child born had been born of a union between a mother and a father. And now Mary is pregnant. What do you think Joseph would have thought? So, his plans were to marry Mary, but now she's pregnant. Everybody's going to know it. And it is believed at this particular time she is showing very well, because you know pregnancies cannot be hidden long, right? When I was in high school, there was a girl that was in our class that wore a coat. And I'm like, good grief, it's hot. We got air conditioner on, and she got a big coat on. We found out later why, because she was trying to conceal something. But Joseph, not only was he an older man and probably had a wife and children from the previous marriage, we find that Joseph was a good man. Joseph was a just man. Joseph was a just man with a plan. The Anchor Bible Dictionary says he was a man devoted to the righteous standards of the Old Testament and thus within the rights to divorce Mary publicly. That would have made for a good story, right? Called this old man calling his woman in before all the people and publicly pronouncing that he is divorcing his wife because she's pregnant. Can you imagine what social media would have done? Good grief. But he chose a less public and even more lenient divorce rather than public accusation when it became obvious in her physical appearance that she was pregnant. It goes on to say that Joseph's high moral standards and his desire not to bring undue infamy on his betrothed, Mary, all of these are in keeping with his character, as we're going to see a little more about here in a few moments, that's exemplified in the biblical account. So what I want us to know at this point, Joseph was a good man with a good plan. His plan was good because he was going to do what he had to do, separate himself from the woman who was carrying someone else's child, but he was not going to do it on the public street to where everybody could see it. He had a plan. I mean, he's got a plan today. You know what you're going to do the rest of your life. You got your plan made, don't you? I mean, you know, right? You're going to work till whatever, and then you're going to live on what you've worked and built up, or Social Security, or whatever. You've got a plan. We have a plan. All right, the next part I want us to look at is God's changing my plans. I don't like to have my plans changed. My wife and I, if we she has a doctor's appointment usually once every 4 months in Jackson, and we go to Jackson. I go with her, and we spend the day in Jackson. I can't leave the house without a plan. Where are we going? What time is the appointment? Where are we going after that? We always go and eat afterwards. She gets the early daylight appointment at 7:30, and then that's us leaving by 5 o'clock or so, and we drive to Jackson, and then I want to know the plan. What are we going to do? Are we going to go eat? Where are we going to go eat? Then where are we going to go? We're going to go shopping. Where are we going to go shopping? I want to know where we're going to shop. I want to know what time we're going to be back home. I need to know these things because I'm a control freak. I have to know, and I have to live up to it, and if it gets off kilter, my blood pressure may go up, and I may have a headache. Anybody with me? But then all of a sudden, Joseph, in his plan, God changes his plans. Matthew 1, verse 20. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife. But God, that's not in my plans because I plan to divorce her quietly. I was going to do it in a nice way, you know, where it wouldn't bring her embarrassment. But now you go bring embarrassment on me? Because it's going to look like she and I were together. Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall. Notice this. She's going to bear the son, but you are going to name him. You are going to call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. And all of this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son. Hey, we remember that, Joseph thought. We remember that scripture from over there in was it Isaiah? We remember that scripture. But now, me, on this moment, in this time, and here I am, an old man with a young bride who's carrying a child, and I've accused her of being with someone else, and I was going to give her a divorce privately. And the angel says, And notice how the angel works here. Notice how Joseph is so open to what the angel, an angel, is saying to him. If an angel showed up to you, even in your dream, could you handle it? Notice this. But the angel says, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. So, Joseph, I'm going to change your plans. That is, you are going to be involved in this prophecy that was given long before your time. So we got to change the plans. You can't divorce her. God has a right to change your plans because you are His. You. God has a right, and put this in your head, God has a right to change my plans because I belong to Him. But we may not like it. We don't like the idea. But God has a right to change your plans. Have you ever felt like God was stirring something within you to change your plans? Sometimes I feel that way myself, right? But then let's look at Joseph's response. Mary's response, her missional response to Christmas was, let it be. Joseph's response was, follow God's plan. Change my plan to follow God's plan. So let's look at this. The first change of plans, Mary. How bad could that be, right? That was the first change of plans was, I can't divorce her, I got to marry her. Matthew 1, 24, 25, when Joseph woke from his sleep, look at what it says, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded. He changed his plan. When he went to sleep, thinking on a divorce. When he woke up, thinking of a wedding. Is that not interesting? God changed his plan in his sleep. Some of us may need to take a nap and let God take control, right? Some of us control freaks, my wife's laughing at me. Some of us control freaks probably need to sit down and shut up and let God, that's what he says, be still and know that I'm God. That means sit down, shut up. Take a nap, let him be God. Because God may be going to change your plans while you're napping. Just let go. So he did as the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son. And that means in a relationship sexually, he did not know her until she'd given birth to a son and called his name Jesus. And look what it says in verse 25, the latter part. And he called his name Jesus. That's what the angel said you're going to do. Joseph did as he was commanded. Are you open today to the commandments of God? Are you open? I'm not talking about the Ten Commandments. You need to be that too. But I'm talking about, should God speak to your heart and you know it's God and there's not a shadow of a doubt? Could be in a dream, could be in other ways. Are you open to doing what he said? So Joseph, this old man, is changing his plan to marry this young virgin who is pregnant, and he has named, because in verse 25, it's past tense, he knew her not until she had given birth to a son, period, and he called his name Jesus. So this little baby that he's rocking and burping and changing here, he knows it's not his son. But he knows it's all a part of the plan. And he gets to play part in God's mission to planet Earth. How cool is that? I'm going to tell you what, you're not going to burp baby Jesus. But you have been called for such a time as this, to play a part in God's plan in the mission to planet Earth. But then let's go a little farther. If I decide to go on a trip with someone and they tell me we're going from point A to point B, I want to go to point B. Don't get halfway there and tell me we're going to go around and do a D and E and then go back to B. I don't do that. I don't do well with that. But look what happened here. There's a second change of plans. Do you see that on the sermon notes? There's a second change of plans. So Joseph has followed the plan in taking Mary to be his wife and naming the baby Jesus, but then look what happens. Matthew 2:13. Now when they had departed, this is speaking of the wise men, all right? When they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. The second time that the angel is appearing to Joseph, changing his plans. And he said, move. How would that fit in your plans today, should God say, move? I've told people before that the last move that we did, I don't ever want to move again. If I ever have to move again, I hope I have enough money to tell the movers where it is and where I want it, right? And I don't have to do anything with it. But here, the angel says to Joseph, move. I thought about the old song, Judy, this morning or yesterday when I was working on this. You remember the old song, you gotta move, you gotta move, you gotta move. When the Lord gets ready, you gotta move, all right? Well, Joseph, you gotta move. Matthew 2:13. When they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, rise, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt and remain there until I tell you. You're going to wait until we change the plans again, right? So you go. For Herod is about to search for the child and destroy him. Look what Joseph did. He changed his plans again. He rose and took the child, even though it required moving from one area to another, and his mother by night, and they departed to Egypt. I don't want to go to Egypt. God says you got to go to Egypt. I want to stay here. You got to go to Egypt. God says you got to go to Egypt. He went to Egypt, verse 15, remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet, out of Egypt I will call my son, or I called my son. So, Joseph, we're changing the plan. That's going to hurt. You're going to have to put forth an effort to leave here and go to Egypt. Nowadays, you'd have to get a passport. You'd have to do all that kind of stuff, take COVID tests and all that kind of stuff. They didn't do that day, but they rode a camel probably or donkeys. I would rather get a passport and a COVID test, wouldn't you? But this was the price you get to pay to be a part of the fulfillment of the prophecy and bring the mission of Christmas to the world. So he moved. He arose and took the child and his mother by night, departed to Egypt, and remained there, stayed there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet, out of Egypt I called my son. Well, aren't you comfortable, Joseph? You got your plan set. But then there is another nap, and there is another time the angel comes. The third time, the third change of plan is, let's move again. Matthew 2:19, but when Herod died, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt, saying, rise and take the child and his mother and go to the land of Israel. For those who sought the child's life are dead. And he rose and took the child and his mother and went to the land of Israel. So we see them. He changed his plans again. He's packed up. He's got the baby, which is growing. And they head out back to Israel. How many's got GPS on your car or on your phone? Anybody can have it. Just download the app. You can have GPS. And has it ever done the rerouting thing? This is D, the fourth change of plan, rerouting. I get aggravated with that thing sometimes. When she tells me, actually, it's not a she now. We've got an English soccer coach, I think, telling us, okay, boys, we're going to hit it to the right now. It's hilarious on ways, but nevertheless, Joseph, pack up. You're on the way to Israel. But in the middle of the trip, we're rerouting. Look what happens, Matthew 2:22. And when he had heard that Archelaus was reigning over Judea in place of Herod his father, he was afraid to go there, and being warned in a dream, he withdrew to the district of Galilee. And he went and lived in a city called Nazareth, so that what was spoken by the prophet might be fulfilled, that he would be called a Nazarene. How many has ever felt like all of the changes that's happening in your life, sometimes it's just so overwhelming, I'm losing control of my life? But there will be a day that you can look back and you can see God's hand and how it all moved. I could stand here for an hour and tell you about mine and Carol's. I'm not going to do that. But how God has done things like that in our life. Submit to and follow God's plan, regardless of how many times you must change yours. You may be a control freak. You may have to have control, but to be a Christian with a missional response to Christmas and the mission of Christmas, you have to be willing to say, God, here are my plans. Do as you will. Jeremiah 29:11 gives us an interesting verse. We used it last Sunday for a different purpose. Look what it says. God says, I know the plans I have for you. We all like that one because we like the latter part of it, plans for welfare. And that doesn't mean what the government means by welfare, but welfare, and not for evil, to give you a hope and a future, or future and a hope. We like that part, but God says, I know the plans I have for you. You think nobody's watching you, nobody's looking at you, your life is worthless, and you feel like it's all going down the drain. One day I'm going to die, and nobody will ever know I ever existed. But I'm going to tell you what. Your Creator, the one who knew you before conception, had a plan for you. And it may cause you to have to change your plan sometimes. But he has a plan for you. Jeremiah 10:23. I know, O Lord, that the way of man is not in himself. Our ways are not in ourself. There is no way that this 18-year-old Gary, when he was graduating from high school, who thought he knew more than he actually knows today, there is no way that he could have gotten to where he is today on his own. And that is not in man. It is not in man who walks to direct his steps. I think I'm in control, but I have to stop and realize that God's leading. Proverbs 16:1, the plans of the heart belong to man, but the answer of the tongue is from the Lord. I love these. Proverbs 16:9, the heart of man plans his ways, but the Lord establishes his steps. Ephesians 1:11, let's take it to the New Testament. Look what it says. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him. The purpose of God. Joseph, this is why you're doing this, because the prophet Isaiah said it was going to happen, and you're the one that gets to help fulfill this. Predestined according to the purpose of him who works all these things according to the counsel of his will. Ephesians 2:10. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. However, modern day Christians would rather be like Frank Sinatra than like Joseph. I'll do it my way. Frank Sinatra saying, and now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I make it clear. I state my case, of which I am certain. I lived a life that's full. I've traveled each and every highway, and more and much more. I did it my way. Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do, and I saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much, much more, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew, and through it all, whenever there was doubt, I ate it up, spit it out, faced it all, stood tall, and did it. I did it my way. I loved, I laughed, I cried. I've had my filling, my share of losing, and now as tears subside, I find that it's also amusing, and to think that I did it all that, and I may say, not in a shy way, oh no, not me, I did it my way. For what is a man, what has he got, if not himself, then he has not. Not to say the things that he truly feels and not the words of someone who kneels. That record show, I took all the blows and I did it my way. So last week, in the Christmas story, we found that God wants our bodies. Present your bodies a living sacrifice, is what Paul said. He wants our bodies to fulfill his plan. This week, we learned that God wants our plans too. God wants you. God wants your plans. Let it be said of me, when I'm gone and I'm remembered, let it be said that he did as he was commanded by God. Do you want to do it your way? Or do you want to do it God's way? One other quick example. Paul, known as Saul at the time in the Bible, had his plans to destroy the church that had begun on the day of Pentecost, to completely destroy it, wipe it away, because that was his plan, to stop it. He even held the garment of the men who were stoning Stephen to death, the very first Christian martyr. He was on his road to Damascus, on the road to Damascus one day, when all of a sudden a bright light shone around him. He fell to the ground and was blinded by the light. And the words from the light from Jesus Christ said, Paul, isn't it hard for you to kick against the goads? Isn't it hard for you to fight this? Saul said, Lord, what would you have me to do? We make our plans, but God directs our steps. For you to fulfill the plan that God has for your life, it would be easier for you to submit as Joseph did, as a missional response to God's mission to planet Earth. You've got a purpose. You've got a plan. God has a plan. Alter your plan to fit God's plan. Will you stand with me? Holy Spirit. We're going to do the same song we did last Sunday. And you can do this as a prayer. If you're having trouble praying, Lord, here I am. Change my plans. You can sing this song with them. Make it as a plan, as a prayer to God. God, I'm going to make room for you. Here's my body. Change my plans.